Let's visualize four E2 reaction mechanisms with increasing difficulty to explain basic concepts like orbitals, conformations, and stereochemistry. After getting smart on different systems and mechanisms, we will use what we've learned to understand a more complicated, exotic reaction. The most important thing to know is that E2 reactions preferentially take place from an antiperiplanar conformation. Why is that? We usually draw that deprotonation with base kicks out a leaving group. The pi system forms via overlap of the sigma CH orbital and the sigma star orbital of the carbon-bromine bond, all within the same plane. An anti-setup maximizes this overlap, but syn-periplanar arrangements are theoretically possible. The orbitals would also be in the same plane, but you can see that overlap is weaker due to worse alignment. Such syn conformations are also energetically disfavored due to eclipsing bonds, so we generally ignore them in favor of staggered ones in the E2 reaction. Based on the orbital alignment, we have a bimolecular concerted transition state just like in the SN2 substitution, and we have no intermediates as opposed to the E1 elimination. For every elimination, we always need to first find the leaving group, second the electrophage, as we will see it's not always a proton, and third, consider the reactive conformations. Our examples will highlight that energetically preferred and reactive conformations can often be different. Let's look at the simple elimination of 2-bromobutane with base. The bromide will obviously eliminate, but 3 types of protons are eligible. First up, the terminal CH3 group is most accessible. Because our base is not sterically hindered, this kinetic product forms in only 20%. Instead, thermodynamic preference is at play. We have additional internal protons, which give rise to more substituted olefins. You will know that these are usually more stable energetically. The two isomers E and Z arise from deprotonation of 2 different protons. How can we rationalize the preferential formation of the E isomer? There are 2 reactive conformations that position the hydrogen and bromide anti to each other. Newman projections show us what the conformation and transition state could look like. The Z alkene is formed upon deprotonation of H1, but this requires both methyls to be quite close to each other. If we rotate the single bond by 120 degrees, we can eliminate this unfavorable gauche interaction. Upon deprotonation of this new H2, the methyl groups are antiperiplanar and nicely avoid each other. The conformational equilibrium lies on the right side, thus the E isomer is formed preferentially. How can we be sure that the concerted E2 mechanism is correct? One piece of evidence are kinetic isotope effects. Maybe you watched my previous video or have heard of them already. Deuterium behaves like hydrogen, but due to its heavier mass, forms stronger bonds with carbon. Elimination of deuterated 2-bromopropane is almost 7 times slower versus hydrogen. So we know that the rate limiting step involves breaking of this particular bond. As a second argument for the concerted mechanism, E2 reactions can be highly stereospecific. Let's look at these 2 diastereomeric educts. Will they lead to the same product? We again know our leaving group and there's actually just 1 hydrogen available. Let's now figure out the conformation again by drawing the Newman projection. If we position H and Br anti, the big phenyl groups also oppose each other. Because of the concerted mechanism, the reaction maintains the arrangement and stereospecifically yields the E alkene. What about the second one? In the only possible anti-conformation, the phenyl groups are gauche to each other, encoding for a Z product. The visual shows us that they are really big, so never be fooled by abbreviations and try to think in 3D. Like our very first example, the single bond rotation equilibrium is clearly not favoring this setup. Most molecules are chilling in a more stable conformation that does not allow for anti-elimination. This leads to a 10 times slower reaction compared to the other diastereomer. To completely put this to bed, the first example we saw exhibited stereoselectivity, with formation of 3 different olefins with different ratios. The second one had stereospecificity because the diastereomers had no other choice but to yield the E or Z alkene respectively. Before we continue, let me thank all my channel members and also you for watching this video. I'm experimenting with some basic but more visual content, so let me know any feedback and suggestions in the comments. Another favorite of many chemistry teachers are cyclohexanes. You will know that substituents like to be equatorial to avoid steric clashes via 1,3-diaxial interactions. However, because the leaving group would be anti to C-C bonds and not any C-H bonds, E2 is impossible. The ring needs to flip to position the leaving group axially, which could be energetically disadvantageous. To illustrate this point, let's consider the elimination of these di-substituted diastereomers cis and trans. The huge third butyl group will dictate our ground state conformation through its equatorial preference, characterized by a large A value. Notice anything different about the isomers? If the bromide is cis, the most stable chair conformation already has the CBr axial and thus anti to two hydrogens. We are ready to eliminate. The trans isomer is not ready. We need a chair flip from a double equatorial to a double axial conformation. This comes with a hefty energy price, so this elimination happens hundreds of times slower. What about this trimethyl silyl compound? Would you expect different reactivity? The answer is straightforward if you know that TMS has a lower A value. But why is that? They might look similar on paper, but again, don't be fooled. Carbon-silicon bond is much longer than carbon-carbon, so the system can avoid some of the unfavorable steric effects that arise from axial positions. Compared to third butyl, it's less bunched up. The diaxial setup is thus less disfavored and would eliminate faster, albeit still pretty slow. To understand the final reaction, we need to arm ourselves with some more advanced mechanisms. Some of you might know the Peterson olefination, which is a silicon variant of Wittig type reactions with two pathways. First, basic conditions facilitate syn elimination, either concerted through a four-membered ring intermediate or a stepwise mechanism. The energetic driving force is formation of the strong silicon-oxygen bond from the relatively weak silicon-carbon bond. As a second pathway, acidic conditions convert the hydroxy group into a better leaving group, which can eliminate in E2 anti-fashion, similar to what we've seen before. Another reaction facilitated by silicon-oxygen bond formation is the Brook rearrangement. Here, an oxyanion intramolecularly attacks a silyl group sitting at the carbon, leading to a silyl migration. This leaves behind a carbanion that is typically simply protonated. Almost 5 decades ago, chemists reported a surprising result when studying beta-hydroxysilanes that also have an alpha-hydroxyl group. You might expect a Peterson syn elimination to the enolate. Instead, the reaction gave the E-silyl enol ether selectively. It looks like we have a hybrid pathway at hand. Our model can help visualize the stereochemistry. A Brook migration of the silyl group occurs first, but instead of protonation of the anion, we can eliminate the beta hydroxy group. If we assume that this conserves the configuration of the educt, we can nicely predict that the anti arrangement encodes the E olefin in the product. As always, we should check the other diastereomer as well. This one leads to the opposite Z olefin with a slightly lower selectivity of 2:1. This could suggest that the pathway is energetically more challenging, potentially proceeding through a more stepwise mechanism which erodes the selectivity. This concludes this video on basics and some more advanced features of E2 reactions. If you learned something, please like and subscribe to my channel and let me know what topics you're interested in most. As always, until next time.